And I'll never forget, every time I got on a plane Monday morning, I always had this great fear. If the plane goes down, will I end up in purgatory or hell? Because heaven wasn't an option. And now I get on a plane and travel all over the world. I know if the plane goes down, immediately I'm in the presence of my Savior. And that's because I have the assurance of eternal life. And Roman Catholics don't have that assurance. They have conditional life.
Just because you stopped believing in purgatory doesn't make it not exist. The good news, though, is that if you keep going on the route you're going to, deceiving people, willingly telling falsehoods about the Catholic Church, sitting in unrighteous judgment against Catholics as you do, you probably won't have to worry about going to purgatory.
What will people think when they hear the love of Jesus ring? What will people do if they find that it's true?
Hey everyone, welcome to Catholicism Wow. So last time, we looked at the first part of Allie Beth Stuckey's podcast with noted world-famous millionaire anti-Catholic Mike Gendron. Allie Beth and Mike both tried to portray Mike Gendron's behavior towards Catholics as being out of love. I definitely shot that idea down. So we still have a lot more video left to get into, probably about 30 minutes, I think, left of the podcast. As with part one, I will be making cuts wherever I can to cut out things that are just dumb and unnecessary, but I will be leaving in anything that's an actual error, that's actual falsehood, that's actual anti-Catholicism that needs to be responded to. So hopefully I get the video finished in this part. There may be a part three. We'll have to find out when we get to the end. When we left off with Allie Beth and Mike, Mike was trying very hard to convince everybody that the Catholic Church invented the idea of venial sin, despite the fact that it's in the Bible in 1 John chapter 5. He said, because we invented venial sin, we had to then invent purgatory, even though that's in the Bible in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And then because we invented venial sin and then had to invent purgatory, we also had to invent indulgences in order to get people out of purgatory. If it doesn't make any sense to you, that's perfectly fine. It doesn't make any sense to me. And I doubt Mike's nonsense makes any sense to him either. So we're going to pick up the conversation right where we left off with Allie Beth and Mike Gendron talking about the deuterocanonical books, following on from their discussion of how Catholics created purgatory, invented it from whole cloth, right out of thin air, even though it was taught by the Apostle Paul in the Bible. So let's get into it.
And then some Catholics will say, well, we get our idea of purgatory from the books of the Bible that Martin Luther removed. And they're referring to the Apocrypha, not a part of the 66 books that we have. What do we make of those? Why aren't they included in our Bible?
Well, the bottom line is because they contain historical, geographical, and theological errors. And so we know that they cannot be inspired by God because God's word is inerrant.
So, Mike, what are these historical, geographical, and theological errors? I notice you don't bring them up. I notice you don't give Catholics the opportunity to respond to them. So what are they? And how are they different than the supposed errors in the proto-canonical books that the atheists bring up? Yes, God's word is inerrant, but God's word is only inerrant in the things that he intends to teach us in his word. Ken Hovind likes to go bandying about saying that the Bible is the most accurate science textbook ever written. It's not. It's clearly not. There are many things in the Bible that don't jive scientifically with knowledge that we have today, but that's because they were written by ancient man. ancient man didn't understand physics, didn't understand the solar system, didn't understand all this knowledge that we've acquired in the last 2,000 years, 5,000 years, whatever. So yes, God's word is inerrant, and the things that he intends to teach us in his word. But God's word is also poetic. God's word is also allegorical. We know God speaks in allegory because Jesus himself taught in parables. Those parables are not historically accurate stories. They didn't happen. They're just things that Jesus, stories that Jesus told to teach a point. And things like that occur in the Bible as well. So please enlighten us, Mr. Gendron. How are these historical, geographical, and theological errors different than the ones that supposedly are in the proto-canonical books? I'll wait.
And they weren't added to the Catholic canon until the Council of Trent. And the reason it was added then is because they needed some justification for the doctrine of purgatory and indulgences. And so in Second Maccabees, they saw when the Maccabeans were killed, many of them were wearing pagan amulets around their neck. And so they sent alms back to Jerusalem for the repose of their soul. So the Catholic Church said, see there, there is an intermediate place, and we can offer alms for the dead in order to get them out of an intermediate place. And so they added the Apocrypha in order to try and support their doctrine of venial sin, purgatory, and indulgences.
So here we go with this lie again. The deuterocanonical books were added at the Council of Trent. Mike Gendron seems to think everything was added at the Council of Trent. I bet if you were to ask him, he would say that the Catholic Church was created at the Council of Trent. Mr. Gendron, the Council of Trent was in the 16th century, 500 years after the East-West Schism. So if the deuterocanonical books were added into the biblical canon at the Council of Trent, why are they in the Orthodox canon as well? Why are they in the Coptic canon? Why are they in the Syrian Church of the East canon? Why are they in every canon except the Protestant canon? And why did Protestant Bibles contain them until 1825 when they were removed to save printing costs? Nothing you say makes any sense because you do not have a basic grasp of anything, including church history. The fact is, the deuterocanonical books, what the Protestants call the Apocrypha, have been included in the biblical canon since the Regional Council of Rome in 382. The Council of Trent did not create the canon. The Council of Trent did not add these books to the canon. The only thing the Council of Trent did was dogmatically define the canon. Because prior to the 16th century, prior to the Protestant Reformation, prior to Martin Luther deciding what is and what isn't scripture all on his own, they weren't in dispute, so there wasn't a reason to have a dogmatically defined biblical canon. You guys made that necessary by taking books out. If you're going to be a Protestant, Mr. Gendron, at least admit to your own history and stop distorting ours.
But we don't do things just because the Jews did them. The Jews did a lot of things that went against Scripture and went against God. In fact, they even rejected the Messiah. So we don't emulate the Jews just because it's in one of their books. And the apocryphal books, they were the intertestament books. The canon was closed 400 years before Christ. And then you had the apocryphal books during that period of time.
Well, and at least with all the dumb things that Mike Gendron says, at least he doesn't fall into the trap of trying to claim that Christians shouldn't accept the deuterocanonical books because the Jews didn't accept them, which is a common Protestant argument for rejecting them.
Now, the second reason why the Protestants would reject the Apocrypha as being inspired by God is because the Jews themselves rejected the Apocrypha and did not consider these books as part of their Old Testament canon or scripture. Now, why is this important? It's important because the argument will go back and forth, and Catholics will say that Protestants removed certain books from the Bible, whereas Protestants will say, well, hey, you know what? You could make an argument that these books should have never been put in the Bible in the first place because the Jews never actually received or believed that these books were on the same divine level and authoritative level as the 39 books that we have in the Old Testament, or if you're a Jew, 22 books.
But again, this doesn't hold water even if Mike were to make this argument, because the Jews also reject the New Testament, so it's almost like we shouldn't take their word for it. However, since Mike doesn't use that argument, let's actually deal with the argument that he does use, that the canon was closed 400 years before Christ. According to who? Who closed it? At what event was it closed? How do we know that it's closed other than because you said a thing? What Jewish documents say that the canon of scripture was closed? And why would the canon of scripture have been closed? The Messiah hadn't come yet. So why would they close the scriptures? Why would they close the canon of scripture knowing that they're still waiting for the Messiah that's being foretold in the scriptures? Like, none of it makes any sense. None of it makes any sense. You add that with, you know, the fact that every church except Protestants accept the deuterocanonical books, everything older than the 16th century accepts them. Even Protestant Bibles contain them for 300 more years after the Protestant Reformation. Mike Gendron is just making stuff up because he's too lazy to actually look into these things. Mike Gendron has a lot in common with James White, and that it seems that they both wrote a speech in the 1990s, memorized it, and have just been regurgitating that same speech for the last 30 some odd years. Even when they're being corrected on the errors in that speech, it's never been refined, revised, rewritten. Mike Gendron just keeps saying the same stupid things he said in the 90s, the same as James White. Grow, people. Grow, learn.
And I'll never forget, every time I got on a plane Monday morning, I always had this great fear. If the plane goes down, will I end up in purgatory or hell? Because heaven wasn't an option.
Now
why? Why? Because even the popes believe they have to spend time in purgatory.
Oh, really?
Yeah, when the last couple of popes died, they had other cardinals come in and perform the sacrifice of the Mass for the purpose of getting the Holy Fathers out of a place called purgatory.
The repose of the soul?
Yeah,
is that what that means?
Right. They were offering sacrifices for the sins of the popes. And so, yeah, there was not an option to go to heaven directly. You had to go through the purging fire of purgatory. And now I get on a plane and travel all over the world. I know if the plane goes down, immediately I'm in the presence of my Savior. Mm-hmm. And that's because I have the assurance of eternal life. And Roman Catholics don't have that assurance. They have conditional life.
Mr. Gendron, an atheist comes up to you and says, you know, I'm so glad that I stopped believing in Christianity. I'm so glad that I left Christianity, because when I was a Christian, every time I got on an airplane, I used to be afraid that I might go to hell. And now that I'm not a Christian anymore, I don't have to worry about that because I don't believe in hell. So now I get on a plane and I have complete assurance because hell isn't real. And if the plane goes down, I won't even know. What would you say to that atheist? You would probably say something similar to this. Just because you stopped believing in purgatory doesn't make it not exist. The good news, though, is that if you keep going on the route you're going to, deceiving people, willingly telling falsehoods about the Catholic Church, sitting in unrighteous judgment against Catholics as you do, you probably won't have to worry about going to purgatory.
And Allie, the difference between having assurance and not is the difference between what are you trusting in? You see, the Catholic Church teaches you must do things to appease God and to merit heaven. The Bible says Christ has done it all. And so if you put all of your trust in what Christ has done, then you can have the assurance of eternal life. As long as you're trusting in what you must do, there can be no assurance. Because how do you know if you've ever done enough? Hmm. But when you trust the perfect sacrifice of Christ in his righteousness, that he canceled the eternal sin debt, that God no longer counts our sins against us, and now he sees us perfectly righteous because the imputation of Christ's righteousness to every believer. And so, you know, the gospel calls this good news. I call it the greatest news a condemned sinner on death row could ever hear. Mm-hmm. That Christ died as a substitute so that you could go free.
The funny thing is, the Bible never says that Christ did everything. The Bible never says that we're not required to do anything because Christ's sacrifice on the cross did it all. In fact, the Bible says the opposite of that. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 27, the Apostle Paul writes, "Do you not know that in a race, all the runners compete, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Well, I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I pummel my body and subdue it, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified." So even the Apostle Paul acknowledges that you must run the race. It's not enough simply to be in the race. There's not a judge out there. We don't let Jesus run the race for us, and then the judge declares us the winner instead of him. That's not how this works. The Apostle Paul goes on in Colossians chapter 1 to write, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I complete what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church." St. Paul did not believe that mere faith was all that was required. Paul did not believe that once you were saved forever. You could stop running the race. You could reject the free gift that was given you. You could choose not to do the works that God has ordained in advance for us to do, Ephesians 2, chapter 10, that Protestants always seem to forget. The New Testament is covered with things you have to do to maintain your salvation. It's not just that you get a pardon and you're released from prison, you're released from death row. You have to do what it takes not to go back to prison.
Hmm. What would a Catholic priest say the gospel is if you were to ask?
Here's an idea. Why don't you ask an actual Catholic priest that question? Why don't you have Father Mike Schmitz on your show? Or Bishop Robert Barron on your show? Why don't you go to the horse's mouth to get the answers to these questions? Because Mike Gendron is not going to give them to you. He's going to tell you what you want to hear. He's going to tell you what you need to hear to be able to say, look at those awful, unsaved Catholics. Isn't it sad? Isn't it sad? They think they have Jesus, but their Jesus is false. They worship statues. They worship a piece of bread. It's so sad. But he's not going to give you the truth. Father Mike Schmitz would give you the truth. Bishop Barron would give you the truth. But you don't ask them to be on your show. Certainly, they're famous enough to be worth your time, right?
It's a good question. Well, you may remember the famous golfer Bruce Litsky. We had a chance to witness to his wife, Rose. She had her kids at Trinity Christian Academy.
That's where I went. I went there, kindergarten through 12th grade, yep.
Well, her kids came home one day and said, Mom, the kids at school are saying, if you're a Catholic, you have no hope of going to heaven. And so she was very distraught.
Of course she was distraught. What an ugly, ugly thing to tell small children at school and send them home to tell that to their parents. That's disgusting. Absolutely disgusting.
And through a mutual friend, she found out about our ministry. And so we went over to her house and sat down with an open Bible. And every time she asked a question, we let God answer the question for her. Mm. And the more questions she asked, the more questions God answered. She just kept going. And then I remember about 3 hours into it, she said, how can I have the same peace that you and your wife have? I said, the peace comes from knowing Christ Jesus as my Savior and knowing that the moment I die, I'm going to be in His presence. And so she said, well, how can I receive that? I said, well, let's let God answer that question too. So I turned to Mark 1:15. I said, read this. The first command of Jesus was repent and believe the gospel. And so the word repent means you need to change your mind about the former way that you were believing you could get to heaven and put your faith in the true gospel. Mm-hmm. And then I took her to Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. I asked her to read it. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Mm-hmm. I said, Rose, look at verse 13. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And so she cried out to the Lord to save her.
This is a manipulation tactic. This is what you see from charlatans like Ray Comfort, Kent Hovind, Mike Gendron. You find some weak person. In the case of Mike Gendron, he preys on Catholics specifically who are weak in their faith, who are maybe culturally Catholic. He preys on them. He scares them. He terrorizes them like he did this poor woman. And then he says, oh, but there's hope. Simply call on the name of Jesus and you will be saved. Never mind everything else that's in the New Testament. Are you going to guide this woman after you drag her out of her church? Now, this woman absolutely sounds like she needed a wake-up call. She had her children enrolled in an evangelical parochial school. That was probably not a good move. She obviously wasn't living her faith. Like I said, she was culturally Catholic. She grew up in it. Probably had icons and statues and crucifixes all over her house. Maybe she even goes to Mass every Sunday. But when was the last time she was in confession? When was the last time she sat down and opened her Bible? When was the last time she engaged with other Catholics about their faith? This woman definitely needed a wake-up call, but she did not need it from a predator like Mike Gendron, who will destroy her entire life and then walk away and leave her to pick up the pieces by herself. This isn't going to make her a stronger Christian. All it's going to do is make her more anti-Catholic. And that's what Mike Gendron is doing. He's not saving souls. He's making anti-Catholics. Evangelicals who don't know the Bible, they don't know their Catholic faith, but they'll get on social media and say, I was a Catholic for 37 years. I never was fed. Yeah, you're going to go to this evangelical megachurch now and you're going to feel some sense of emotion, but you're still not being spiritually fed. And the spiritual food that you were getting at the Catholic Mass has been taken away from you.
And then she said, well, what am I going to do now? I've just been named fundraiser at All Saints Catholic Church, and my son's an altar boy. I've got to go talk to the priest. And so she set up an appointment, asked if I would go with her, and I said, sure, because I'm aware of the parable of the seed. It was sown on her heart. I didn't want to leave her one-on-one with a priest that could pluck it away. Mm. And so I walked in, I introduced myself to the priest, and I said, could you share with Rose how she has any hope of going to heaven? And so he started listing the requirements. Well, she has to be baptized. That's the sacrament of regeneration and justification. Then she has to receive the sacraments. They are required for salvation. She has to attend the weekly sacrifice of the Mass. She has to do good works in order to be justified. She has to keep the law. So I saw a Bible on his desk, and I said, could you open to the book of Romans? And I'd like you to read a couple of verses. And so he did. And I said, how are you going to reconcile what God has just said with what you told Rose? Well, now he knew why I was there.
He said, he didn't like it.
No, he said, this meeting is over. I said, no, there's nothing more important than settling this woman's eternal destiny. And so for the next 15 minutes, he tried to reconcile God's word with the Catholic plan of salvation. And each time he did, I brought up another verse that refuted what he just said. And he was just getting so frustrated and so angry to the point where he said, look, this meeting is over. And so we got up, we walked out, and I opened my Bible to 2 Corinthians 4:2. I said, Rose, look at this. God presents the truth plainly to every man's conscience in the sight of God. We don't rely on the bishops to interpret the scriptures for us. Mm-hmm. The scriptures weren't written to bishops. They were written to the saints at individual churches. She said, oh, Mike, I know I can never go back to this church. Here was a man with a collar on. He couldn't even tell me how to get to heaven. Mm. So a long answer to your question, but that's the Catholic gospel.
So you terrorized this poor woman. You got her so confused and afraid that she would have listened to anything you told her. You cherry-picked and manipulated the Bible to do this, to emotionally manipulate her. And then you went and you bullied her priest. I'm sure the priest, if this story is even true at all, I'm sure the priest was giving you good answers. And all you were doing was sitting there and arguing with him, cherry picking the scriptures, bullying. There comes a time when somebody needs to kick the dust of people like you off of their shoes. That's what that priest was doing. And unfortunately, this poor woman, Rose, is the one that lost. Because you were more concerned about beating the Catholic Church than actually doing what was right for her. And then, after you bullied her priest, you read her this verse, 2 Corinthians 4:2. We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word, but by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Wow. Your manipulation game sure is strong, Mr. Gendron. You, sir, are a serpent. You're a predator. You go around looking for these weak Catholics, these Catholics who are not strong in their faith, and you rip them right out of the arms of God. Yeah, that priest failed Rose. He did. He failed Rose by not being able to defeat you in front of her. And that's a shame, because you're easily defeated. Of course, this story might not be true. We all know that Mike Gendron is a storyteller. He excels in fiction. But it makes for good copy, doesn't it?
And priests say they don't have the authority to interpret the scriptures. They have to rely on their bishops. By the way, the Catholic Church teaches the bishops are the only authentic interpreters of God's word. That's why whenever I witness to a priest, they say, you got to come back home to Holy Mother of the Church, because you have no authority to interpret the scriptures on your own.
All right, so this is another thing that Mike Gendron likes to do, is say a thing that's technically true, but in a way that leads you to believe something that's completely untrue, right? So he says even the priests aren't allowed to interpret the Bible for themselves. That's a lie. Priests read and interpret the Bible every week when they sit down to write a homily. A homily is literally them teaching on the scriptures that were read that day in Mass. Now, if we look at the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraphs 85 and 86, it says, the task of giving an authentic interpretation of the Word of God. See, Mike Gendron used that word, authentic, and that's true. The task of giving an authentic interpretation of the Word of God, whether in its written form or in the form of tradition, has been entrusted to the living teaching office of the Church alone. Its authority in this matter is exercised in the name of Jesus Christ. This means that the task of interpretation has been entrusted to the bishops in communion with the successor of Peter, the Bishop of Rome. Yet this magisterium is not superior to the Word of God, but is its servant. It teaches only what has been handed on to it. At the divine command, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, it listens to this devotedly, guards it with dedication, and expounds it faithfully. All that it proposes for belief as being divinely revealed is drawn from this single deposit of faith. So the reason why the magisterium, the bishops in communion with the Pope, have the task of authentically interpreting the scripture is because they're the guardians of the deposit of faith in both written and oral sacred tradition. But this doesn't mean they're the only ones that can read the Bible and know what the Bible means. That's preposterous. And how do I know that's preposterous? I'm not going to read them because it's a lot. But if you look in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraphs 111 through 119, it tells you, every paragraph, exactly how to read and interpret the Bible for yourself and how to do it in an honest and intellectual way that is not going to lead you into error. So the Catechism literally gives you advice on how to authentically read the Bible. The job of the magisterium is not to tell you everything that the Bible means. If it were, we would have entire libraries of magisterial teaching, of commentaries on everything in the Bible from, you know, every pope. We don't have that because we don't need that, because Catholics can absolutely read and interpret the Bible for ourselves, and we can follow the advice in the catechism and do it authentically and correctly. The authentic interpretation entrusted to the magisterium simply means that they tell you what the Bible can't mean. You cannot read the Bible and come away thinking that Jesus has, that Jesus is not fully God and fully man, right? That he has a divine nature or a human nature, but not both. You can't read the Bible and come to those conclusions. Those are heresies. And in paragraph 133 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, it says, "The Church forcefully and specifically exhorts all the Christian faithful to learn the surpassing knowledge of Jesus Christ by frequent reading of the divine scriptures. Ignorance of the scriptures is ignorance of Christ." And that last bit was a quote from Saint Jerome. So official Catholic Church teaching is not only can you read the Bible for yourself, but you should read the Bible for yourself. And you only go to the bishop to solve a dispute. And you can go to the priest. And if the priest is able to solve the dispute before taking it to the bishop, great. But everything, like this whole video, like the last video and the next video, because this is definitely going to be three parts, I've decided. This is all lies. All Mike Gendron does is lie.
I'm so curious to hear your insight into Marian doctrine, because I've talked about this with Catholics, with Trent Horn. We really got into it on the doctrine of Mary. And this is something that I've found a lot of my Catholic friends are very defensive about. They will say, we do not worship Mary, we don't pray to Mary or pray to any saints, we pray through them. And because they are spiritually alive in heaven, then it's fine to pray to them. And why not pray through Mary, since she is the closest to Jesus and he will never refuse her? That's the kind of language that I hear. So before, I mean, I won't give my thoughts and I have my own thoughts, but what's your take on that?
The Catholic Church gives Mary a lot of attributes that are reserved for God alone. In fact, in the Catechism, it teaches that Mary was the cause of salvation for herself and the whole human race. And she continues to bring us the gifts of salvation.
All right. So paragraph 494 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church does use that phrase that he just said, that Mary is the cause of salvation for the whole human race. That is not unique to the Catechism of the Catholic Church. That is not a unique Catholic teaching. That is a quote from Saint Irenaeus. Now, I bring up the early church fathers a lot. So everybody that's a regular viewer of my channel knows Saint Irenaeus was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a disciple of Saint John the Apostle. So Irenaeus is only two generations removed from an actual follower of Christ. He is only teaching what was taught to him, handed down from the Apostle John. So your beef, Mr. Gendron, is not with the Catholic Church. It's with the authors of sacred scripture, the apostles. Now, what does it mean Mary was the cause of salvation for the whole human race? It means she brought salvation into the world by bringing the Savior into the world. No Mary, no Jesus. Now, that doesn't mean that God could not have sent the Messiah by other means. Of course he could. He's God. He can do whatever he wants to. But he chose to send the Word, the Logos, the Son, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ. He chose to send his Son to the world in human flesh, born of human flesh. And for that, he needed a vessel. And because God gives us free will, he needed a vessel that would give him, that would give herself to him of her own free will. which Mary did. Mary, in saying yes to God, brought salvation into the world by bringing her son, Jesus Christ, into the world. This isn't that complicated.
And it's interesting because if she's the cause of salvation for herself, that means she was a sinner that needed salvation. But yet the Catholic Church esteems Mary as sinless. They teach the Immaculate Conception, that she was conceived without sin. And then they teach that she lived a life without sin. And so that was pronounced in 1854, the dogma of Immaculate Conception.
And of course, here is Mike Gendron once again saying things that are sort of true, but completely untrue. The Immaculate Conception was made a dogma of the church in 1854. That's true. But if you look back, it's taught as far back as the earliest church fathers. Irenaeus taught about the sinlessness of Mary. Tertullian, St. Justin Martyr. It was a common belief in the earliest church that Mary was without sin. This is not just something that the Catholic Church made up. And if Mike Gendron cared enough to research what the earliest Christians believe, which by his own admission he refuses to do, he would know this.
Well, Catholics began asking the question, well, if Mary never sinned, and sin is what causes death, where's Mary? And so in 1950, they had to come up with another infallible dogma that Mary was miraculously assumed into heaven. So she never died. She was assumed into heaven.
And she was a perpetual virgin, they say,
yes.
Right? They didn't, that she didn't have children, which I'm
right.
Not sure how they square that with scripture that says that Joseph and Mary did not consummate their marriage until Jesus was born. And then there's also, there are references to Jesus's brothers and sisters in scripture, but the retort that I hear is that that's just a misinterpretation.
Well, Allie Beth, and the way we square that with what's written in the Bible is that we actually know how to read the Bible and we know what words mean, which you clearly do not. We know that in John 3:16, when Jesus says to Nicodemus, "For God so loved the world, that so is not being used as a measure of intensity." We also know that the word "until" doesn't always imply that something is going to stop or reverse after that time. Jesus said, "Behold, I will be with you always, even until the end of the age." Does that mean that at the end of the age, Jesus will stop being with us? No, of course not. That's ridiculous. All that meant that Joseph did not know Mary until the child was born. It doesn't mean he definitely knew her after that. And again, the perpetual virginity of Mary goes all the way back to the earliest church fathers, the earliest ones, the first century, the very early second century. I mean, if you want to refute Catholicism, you should actually have a good understanding of Catholicism, because if you don't even know how far back some of our beliefs go, you really have no reason speaking on this. And it's the same thing with the Dormition / Assumption of Mary. That goes all the way back to the palm narratives of the second century. These are ancient teachings. We have not created anything whole cloth or made anything up. These are literally things that we have been believing for centuries, that the earliest Christians, before any schisms, before Protestantism even existed, the earliest Christians believed these things. The followers of the apostles believed these things, which leads a reasonable person to believe that the apostles believed these things. These are apostolic tradition. They come down to us from the apostles. And you can look back in history and trace these beliefs almost all the way back to them.
It's really sad. In 2 Corinthians 11, Paul talks about how Eve was tempted by Satan, and he said, I'm concerned that your devotion to Christ, your pure devotion to Christ, may be led astray. And how is pure devotion to Christ led astray? By venerating or turning to other people such as Mary and the saints?
No, that's not what Paul is saying. Paul is not talking about the veneration of saints or statues or icons or anything like that. Paul is specifically writing about Gnosticism and the Gnostic heretics that were leading people astray in the first century. And strangely enough, he was also, as it turns out, making a prediction about the Protestant reformers who did the same thing.
Why did they establish this Marian doctrine? Why did they decide that Mary is someone that you pray through? Where does that come from? It does not come from Scripture. I've asked very smart Catholics to show me even where Scripture alludes to that. Mm-hmm. And I do not get a response. I've never gotten a response. So where does that doctrine come from?
So Allie Beth asked this exact question to Trent Horn. And unfortunately, Trent Horn completely dropped the ball on the whole thing. She even sets him up. She sets him up to give her the perfect, correct, biblical response, and he just fumbled the ball. He goes off, and it wasn't even her taking him on tangents to where he didn't have the opportunity to answer the question. He was going off on tangents on the early church and the catacombs, and let's just take a look.
No.
You seem very confident that the souls in heaven do not know anything on earth or can't hear our requests. What is the source of your confidence in that?
No, I didn't say that I'm confident that they can't hear or that they can't see. I didn't say that.
Okay.
I said that we don't see that rule supported in Scripture that they are carrying our request to God. And I think my other piece of confusion about that, I guess not, this piece of confusion wouldn't apply to that example that you gave, the grandparent, because I'm guessing that maybe the child would be the only one praying to that grandparent. But when you've got Mary and you have all of these millions of people asking her for intercession, is Mary in the Catholic view omniscient? Like, how does she order all of these prayers? If she is a human who is, of course, now in heaven, it would necessitate ascribing to her godlike characteristics of omnipotence and omniscience if she can hear the prayers of millions of Catholics at once.
Well, I would say that Mary's ability to hear multiple requests in different languages, that doesn't fall under omniscience. Because omniscience means that you have all knowledge, all truths. Like,
right.
you know, for example, the solution of every single possible mathematical equation.
Yeah.
The saints in heaven don't need to know that. They don't need to know pi, all the decimal places of pi. So it's not omniscience. The knowledge of the saints in heaven, even if it is vast by human standards, it's still infinitesimally small compared to the infinite knowledge of God. You see,
but you believe that there is some kind of not just spiritual transformation, but that there is an incredible expansion of people's capacity to know and to do when we get to heaven. That includes the ability to discern millions of prayers at once in all different languages, somehow prioritize, order, carry those requests to God, and that Mary has achieved that kind of transformation and expansion of her capacity and all of the saints as well. Where does that idea come from?
Well, I would say there is nothing to restrict an omnipotent God from allowing his creatures to have more cognitive abilities.
Sure. Yeah. Nothing can restrict God from doing anything.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if that's necessarily, if that answers my question.
Well, you're asking
how she does that.
She couldn't do it on her own, and I would say God allows her to do that. That just as God can give humans on earth supernatural knowledge of the future, for example, like to be a prophet, or God can give people knowledge of things they wouldn't naturally have.
Mm-hmm.
God can give the saints in heaven knowledge and abilities they would not naturally have on earth, or have in accord with just their own abilities.
So where do Catholics get that idea that he has granted Mary the ability to answer all these prayers and to kind of specially give them to Jesus?
Well, I would say that there is a long tradition of this. Like if you go to the catacombs, for example, that the very first Christians who were, you know, it's very difficult to find early examples of like for me, when I was in my conversion, and what I did was first I listened to all kinds of William Lane Craig.
You can see she sets him up. How do you know the saints carry our prayers to God? How do you know that God endows them with the ability to hear our prayers and to carry them to Christ? How do we know this? I don't see it alluded to in the Bible. All right, Allie Beth, if you are watching this video, which you're probably not, but on the outside chance that you are watching this video, I am sorry that Trent Horn dropped the ball, and presumably Michael Knowles and anybody else, that any other Catholics that you might be friends with that you may have asked this question to, have not given you a sufficient response. So here is the response that Trent Horn should have given you when you asked him the absolute perfect question to give you this answer. It's in Revelation 5:8. Revelation 5:8 says, "And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp with golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints." So here we see in Scripture, saints in heaven, the 24 elders, physically carrying and delivering the prayers of the saints on earth, us, to Jesus. There you go. That's the answer.
Allie Beth, it goes back to, once you no longer submit to the supreme authority of God's word, then you allow religious traditions to come in. And this is what happened down through the years. They started elevating Mary. And, you know, you look at the Queen of Heaven, it's in Jeremiah 44, it was a pagan goddess. And yet they call Mary the Queen of Heaven because Jesus is the King of Heaven. Jesus is an advocate, so they elevate Mary to be an advocate. Now, Jesus is the only sinless mediator, clearly stated in 1 Timothy 2:5. But yet they declare Mary was also a sinless mediatrix of all grace. And so where did it come from? Through not submitting to the authority of God's word, to allow traditions to come into the church. And
2 Timothy 2:5 doesn't say anything about Jesus being the only sinless mediator. The word sinless was added into that passage by Mike Gendron. See, Protestants have to do this. Protestants have to add words to the Bible to make it say what they want it to say, instead of just reading what it plainly says. And I showed in part one from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, where the Catholic Church absolutely affirms that Jesus is the only mediator between God and man. I also explained what it means for Mary to be unofficially called the co-mediator. I also showed in part one where the apostles themselves, Paul wrote to Timothy and said, "Pass on the things that I've preached to you." He said this while he was writing sacred scripture. The Bible does not ever say that every apostolic teaching was written down. It says the opposite of that. I mean, Mike Gendron is just a broken record.
Yeah, we talked about Jesus only starting one church. Yes, he started your church and my church and the Catholic Church. We can all trace our roots back to Matthew 16:18, where Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So what is the nature of the church of Jesus Christ? You're not baptized by water in order to gain entrance. You're baptized by the Holy Spirit. We see that in 1 Corinthians 12:13. We are baptized by one Spirit into one body. That is the Church of Christ. And it has one head. The Catholic Church has two heads. They submit to the Pope as head as well.
And everything in that last statement was just biblically illiterate and incorrect. We see in John 3:5 that baptism is by both water and the Spirit. There are two elements to a baptism, not just one. Yes, Paul says we have one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And this is how baptism was understood by unanimously, universally, by the early church. Baptism by water forgives sins and causes regeneration. And the church is constantly being referred to as an authoritative body, not just the body of all believers, which, yes, they are part of the church. All the believers are part of the church. But Jesus chose one set of apostles. That one set of apostles chose successors and gave them the authority to choose their successors. Again, we see this in the earliest Christian writings from Saint Clement, who knew the apostles personally. Everything Mike Gendron says is wrong, and it's not just incorrect, it's lies, because he's been saying these same things since the 90s, and he's been being corrected on these errors since the 90s. He's not mistaken. He's lying.
And we look at the true church, every member of the true church of Jesus Christ, their name is enrolled in heaven. Well, that disqualifies the Catholic Church, because they would be the first to admit that not all Catholics will go to heaven. If they die in the state of mortal sin, then they'll go to hell. And so, again, that goes against the whole doctrine of justification.
So, Mr. Gendron, are you saying that everyone who professes to be a Christian goes to heaven, and that acknowledging that not everyone who professes to be a Christian goes to heaven, that automatically disqualifies you as being the true church? I don't understand. You said earlier that there are lots of Protestant denominations that have slipped into, as you say, apostasy, even though you use that word wrong. The word you're looking for is heresy. But I don't get what you're saying. Yes, we acknowledge that not everybody who professes the Catholic faith lives the Catholic faith. As I'm sure you would say that not everyone who professes the Christian faith lives the Christian faith. And as for the Catholic understanding of justification going against the doctrine of justification that you seem to think your understanding is automatically a fact, what makes your understanding of justification right and ours wrong? We get ours out of the same Bible you get yours from. I've already shown that. We get all of our doctrines, most of our doctrines, the lion's share of our doctrines, straight out of the Bible, either explicitly or implicitly. I've already shown that. So what makes your understanding of the scripture right and ours wrong? If only. God had had the foresight to put in the Bible a mechanism for us to settle such disputes.
Mm-hmm. So who do they believe goes to heaven immediately? Anyone?
No.
Not even someone that they elevate to the place of saint?
No.
It's just some people spend longer time in purgatory,
right,
to be purged of our sinfulness, even the Pope, he said.
Yes, even the Pope had venial sins that had to be purged away.
So Jesus' death did not earn salvation for anyone, really, according to that doctrine, because if after you die, you still have to be cleansed of your sin, then the sacrifice was insufficient, right?
That's right. Yeah, when you get right down to it, the Jesus of the Catholic Church merely opened the gates of heaven. Now Catholics must do their part to get through those gates. Hmm. It all depends on what they do, and whether or not they can die in the state of grace, albeit venial sins instead of mortal sin.
Jesus, as the one mediator between God and man, is what made it possible for us to be reconciled to God. But he does not reconcile us to God without any part of our own, without any cooperation on our part. All over the New Testament, you see that works are a requirement. Matthew 25, Jesus says, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick and in prison. And if you don't do these things, you go to hell. We see that what saves is faith working through love. We see St. Paul says, these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. Love is a verb. Love requires action on our part. We have to cooperate with the grace that God gives us. For it is grace that you've been saved through faith. That is a free gift, not of yourselves, lest any man should boast. And we are his workmanship, created to do good works, which God ordained in advance for us to do. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. That's what happens when you read the whole Bible and you don't cut off verses that are inconvenient for you or cherry pick the things that you like and leave away the things that you don't like. When you read the whole Bible, when you get a whole picture of salvation, we have to cooperate with that salvation. Our works are necessary. Our works do not save us. Faith in Christ saves us. But we cannot be saved. We do not have true faith. We are not living our faith if we do not have the works as well. Yes. Jesus opened the gates of heaven. It's up to us to choose to walk through them. All right, we're going to stop there. We're going to pick this conversation up with statues and the Ten Commandments starting in part three. I cannot with my Gendron. I just can't. So everybody, that's all I have for you today. If you like this video, share it with your friends, share it in your social media groups. If you're not already subscribed to my channel, please hit the subscribe button. Make sweet, sweet love to the notification bell. Thank you everybody for joining me. Go in peace and have a nice day.